For our members who have attained the quorum, it is about time to make a start. A warm welcome to you all. The main thrust of our discussion is the policy address, so we have sufficient time for our discussion this afternoon. Item 1, Ms. Claudia MO on the 23rd of January wrote to me indicating her intention to join the Environmental Affairs Panel, and on the 24th of January, by way of paper CB 1456, stroke 12 to 13, bracket 01, made available the letter to members. Under House Rules 23B and C, members are supposed to indicate their intention to join before the deadline. However, if for some reason, like absence from Hong Kong or being indisposed, and they are later in their application to join, this can still be handled. The chairman will have the full prerogative to decide, but I'd just like to put it to members. Mr. Gary Fan. No objection, Madam Chair, but I'm inexperienced member here. In the past, I mean, did we have cases like this very often? Now, maybe some members do not know about the workload, and they would like to join after the deadline. Yes, it may happen from time to time. My recollection is that we normally would deal with this leniently. Now, it may happen that it may happen more often that there are more members signing up for a particular panel. I leave it to members to decide. So if you have no objection, I'd like to welcome Ms. Claudia MO in the panel, and she may join us for the next meeting. All right, moving on next to the minutes of the meeting held on November the 26th, paper CB 1430, stroke 12 to 13, we have received no proposed amendments. Can I take the minutes as confirmed? And since the last meeting, we have received three papers, CB 1352, stroke 12 to 13, and that is a study of the air pollution index reporting system. The second one is CB 1445, stroke 12 to 13, bracket 01. There's a paper submitted by Mr. SIN Chung-kai, Mr. Chi-wai, Ms. Helena WONG regarding the interim review 2013 of the scheme of control of two power companies. The third one is CB 1445, 12 to 13, bracket 02. There's some Friends of the Earth's submission regarding the review of the control scheme of the two power companies. This morning, the Economic Development Panel had a briefing, and the electricity issue falls within the EDP. We have referred the submission to the EPD chairman. The chairman, Mr. Jeffrey Lam, will be conducting a public briefing, a public hearing. All members will be invited, so please look out for the date to be scheduled. Right, items for discussion at the next meeting, which is scheduled for the 25th of February 2013, on Monday. The administration proposes two items, review of the air pollution index reporting system and the producer responsibility scheme for glass beverage bottles. Shall we invite the administration in as well, because this is related to them directly. There are other suggestions, Mr. Chen Hanpen. Madam Chair, I'm very loud, am I? Oriented Daily today, the front page story is in Ma Tau Tong village. There is some illegal fly tipping of asbestos. I understand this has been going on for some time, for about a year at least. The complaints were lodged with the department, but no follow-up action was undertaken. I remember that we did discuss fly tipping before. Because of this breaking story, I'm wondering whether we can invite the administration to come and brief us. Is it this panel or is it a development panel in terms of fly tipping? Well, it contains asbestos, right? Asbestos definitely has to do with us, but if you talk about illegal dumping of materials, it has to do with the development panel. Mr. Gary Chen, Madam Chair, by way of information, I remember last time Mr. Li Wing Tat was responsible for a subcommittee on fly tipping under this panel. Now, this has to do with the EPD. Definitely, asbestos is something that falls within our remit. So I agree with Mr. Chen Han Pan that perhaps we should follow this up in the best way that you see fit. Right, do you want to include this for the next meeting or shall we put it on the list? Dr. Elizabeth Quart, well, Madam Chair, this is an urgent matter. We should discuss this as soon as possible. Right, there are two items there. 2 hours may not be sufficient for an additional item because we may spend 10 minutes on the matters arising and so on. So at the meeting scheduled for the 25th of February, can we extend the meeting a little bit? Please have a look at your diary.
2月25日,
February the 25th, a Monday. Can we extend the meeting by 30 minutes? Any problem? Is it fine by the administration? Well, we need their presence. You might come back to us on this. If the secretary can locate at least someone from the bureau or the department. So the regular meeting for scheduled for the 25th of February, we are going to have 3 items between 2:30 and 5 p.m. Right then. Next, we move on to briefing by the secretary for the environment and on the environmental initiatives in the Chief Executive's 2013 policy address. This is the only item we have on the agenda. And we try to make it as liberal as possible. Members would have ample time for your questions. Secretary, please. We're going to have 2 hours. Perhaps I'd like to spend a little bit more time explaining the environmental protection and nature conservation in the policy address. Of course, we'd like to strike a balance. One of the key things in the policy address is that we emphasize everybody's responsibility regarding the environment. We'd like to engage the public for discussion and take joint responsibility. Of course, we'd like Hong Kong to be a more healthy, livable and green city. And nothing will happen overnight. We do need time to pave the way, to lay the good foundation. We'd like to, as if we plant a tree today, so that we can benefit the next generation. There are a number of priority areas, but the key ones are air quality, resources, sustainability. We'd like to approach these municipal solid waste from a new angle. We're not dealing with tail end treatment. I would like to deal with the problem at source. The third one is a low carbon city. We talked about energy supply this morning at the EDP. As we understand, in terms of demand, 90% of the electricity is consumed by buildings. How can we promote green buildings so that we can reduce energy, reduce consumption of energy, and reduce emission? Fourth is nature conservation. Now, how can we strike a balance between conservation and development? And this is the key thing. Now, other than the hardware, we do need to carry the public with us before we can get the job done well. In terms of air quality, our overriding objective is to take public health as the core of our business. By 2020, we aim to achieve new AQOs. We will be posting, we will be introducing the new AQOs to electrical in the future. In terms of air quality or roadside air quality, we've seen improvements in terms of SO2 and RSP. But in terms of NOx, nitrogen oxide, we haven't seen all that significant changes. We have seen an increase in the roadside NOx by the roadside, so we have to tackle the problem where it occurs. Now, the days of exceedances, and the blue ones are more stable, but on the roadside, the situation is not all that optimistic, so we know where the problems are. When we talk about air quality, it is rather complicated, so we do need a whole basket of measures. And we are introducing a new air blueprint. We're going to have a new ideas to take this forward. In the meantime, we do need to take specific measures, like the phasing out of the old commercial diesel vehicles. And in terms of RSP and NOx, they are contributing to the air pollution. Diesel commercial vehicles may take up 20% of the vehicle fleet, but the RSP is 92%, and NOx, it is 53%, so the problem is rather significant. Last year, the WHO pointed out that diesel vehicles' emissions are highly carcinogenic. Now, let's have a look at the statistic, the number of models for the diesel commercial vehicles. The latest is Euro 5, and Euro 6 is going to be coming on stream. If you compare between Euro 5 and pre-Euro, we talk about 34% in terms of RSP, 18% for Euro 1, 7.5% for Euro 2 times. So there is a big difference between old and new diesel vehicles. So we are determined to tackle these particular problems. We have to start with Euros 1, 2, 3, and 4. So we have to minimize the impact on the public health.
This is another diagram in a chart form to make a comparison between pre-Euro, Euro 1, Euro 2, Euro 3 buses, and you see that the range or the difference is really big. We have this goal and the roadmap, and we have allocated resources for our environmental protection initiatives. Actually, the government is very determined. We will be allocating $10 billion to phase out a total of 88,000 pre-Euro and Euro 1, 2, 3 vehicles by phases. Well, we've been providing an incentive program, but the effect has not been very remarkable. So that's why we have to strengthen our initiatives and also make regulations to achieve the desired objective. Now, as for the ex-gratia payment proposed, we've got several options. One is the polluter pays principle. So the vehicle owner has to shoulder the major part of the responsibility. We will do it in a fair and reasonable manner for vehicles of an older age. The compensation is less, and vice versa. So we would also be providing more incentives and more choices for vehicle owners to replace. And we've got this additional option for car vehicle owners who don't intend to replace their cars. And if those who are going to replace their cars, there will be a higher percentage of excretion payment for them. Overall, we aim at achieving this objective by certain emission reduction targets by 2015. So we propose three phases of implementation based on the different models of the vehicles. On license renewal, for Euro 1 and Euro 2 cars, they're mostly over 15 or 18 years of age, and for Euro 3 cars, they are for an age of older 15 years. And actually, in many mainland cities, the legislation has been put in place long ago to phase out these old diesel commercial vehicles. We are trying to catch up with what we've not done in the past. We would also, we've received a very positive response. And also, for newly registered diesel commercial vehicles, we will set a statutory retirement age of 15 years to tie that in line with advanced cities. Looking at the roadside air quality, buses, route rationalization, SCR retrofitting, and trial of hybrid and e-buses would be part of our measures. PLB buses and BLB for LPG taxis and minibuses, we have also applied for funding to replace their catalytic converters. And we will also strengthen our roadside monitoring by deploying remote sensing devices. In our blueprint, we will also mention about electric vehicles, how they can be used to improve air quality in Hong Kong. There are other sources of air pollutants. Marine vessels are also taking up a large part of the emission of the Hong Kong in 2011. As far as nitrogen oxides and sulfur oxides, and they are emitting a lot of pollutants, and we are legislating, exploring on mandate fuel switch at berth for ocean going vessels. We are going down the route of regulating and legislation. We would also explore with Guangdong on mandatory fuel switch at Pearl River Delta ports, or rather, turning it into a low-emission control area. Everybody is also concerned about the Kai Tak Cruise Terminal, which will be commissioned at the middle of this year. It is situated within the middle part of Victoria Harbour. We'll try various means to minimize pollution, including providing onshore power facilities and encouraging vessels to switch to clean fuel. We've got also ferries which are emitting. So we are testing out and requiring local vessels to switch to use of cleaner fuel. Apart from air quality, I'm now going to talk about recycling in Hong Kong. Overall, there are 13,500 tons going to the landfills. The recycling rate is not too bad, 48%, that there is room for improvement. Food waste takes up one-third of the MSW going to landfill. Per capita, waste is 1.3 tons, and it is several times more than Taipei and other cities. So this is the crux of the problem. Hong Kong 1.36 kg, Taipei 1, Tokyo 1.01, so 0.95. This is really a crisis. We have to make reduction a source. In the first quarter of this year, we will be coming up with this resources sustainability blueprint with lots of statistics to explain the situation and with a number of proposals. Reduction a source will be the focus of the blueprint. We are producing a high level of waste per capita. In neighboring cities, they have implemented a waste charging scheme to encourage people to reduce waste as source. We will have talked to the SDC to engage the public in coming up with a waste charging system and to come up with a proposal, legislative report for the electrical diseases. We hope to reduce 20 to 13% of our waste. We have been initiating a cultural or behavioral change in the past, and we want to do more on that front. For the tricolor bin, the effect has not been too bad. Of course, there is room for improvement overall. We have a recycling rate of 48%, and we hope to achieve, would increase it to 50% by 2015. Reduction at source. Food waste is a major problem. So last year, we launched the Food Wise Hong Kong campaign, and we hope that Hong Kong people can reduce the food waste. Reduction at source is a major focus. And we want people to donate food. And then we can also recover energy from waste and also come up with compost products from food waste. And early this year, we hope to launch major publicity drives in that campaign. This is a new committee, and we are action-based, and we hope to work with other sectors to reduce waste. And in 2 to 3 years' time, we hope to cut food waste by at least 10%. Also, we are giving full support to recycling industries in public goods cargo, public cargo working area. We hope to allocate some land for the recycling industry because many of the recycled materials are for export, and we hope to provide facilities to support them in that regard. And later on, we'll be talking about glass beverage bottles recycling. We hope to recreate more jobs, and we hope to recycle them into construction materials, environmentally friendly tiles. Worldwide, countries have adopted a blueprint for resource sustainability, including prevention, reuse, recycling, recovery, and so on. So in the blueprint, we'll be giving you a lot of data and many suggestions. The third aspect is low carbon living. For the two power plants, we have some requirements on them. On the demand side is another major focus. In Hong Kong, 90% of the electricity is related to buildings. 60% of the green the greenhouse gas is emitted from buildings, and we hope to improve on that situation. Different government departments have been working very hard, and in the policy address, one emphasis is to coordinate different bureaus and departments to come up with to achieve breakthroughs, so the improvement can be made in both government buildings and private buildings, not only on existing buildings, because there are development projects coming on stream. We will hope to promote environmental protection as far as those buildings are concerned. We've been doing energy saving charter, green accreditation schemes, and green legislation as well. Through green buildings, we hope to promote low carbon living and energy conservation. We would also be promoting carbon audits in the middle of this year. We would be establishing a carbon print repository for listed companies to encourage disclosure and share useful practices, to encourage big enterprises to do more or take a leading role in cutting carbon emission. In many cities, this is the way that is being implemented. Fourth, nature conservation. Hong Kong has followed the footsteps of the mainland, and we will be devising this biodiversity strategy and action plan. And this year and next year, we will be launching PE exercises to formulate the plan. And in 2015, the plan will be implemented. I understand that many people are concerned that in compiling this action plan, Hong Kong is facing pressure on the development side. How to strike a balance between the two is something that we wish to achieve. For water, maritime, and marine animals, we would hope to give greater protection to them. So much for the fourth aspect. If we want to achieve good results, we must build a green community. So in the policy address, we would say we would be we'll be injecting $50 billion into the Yi Environment and Conservation Fund to support various green projects, supporting green enterprises, promoting low carbon living, and supporting housing estates to recycle food waste, Longyun ecological conservation project, and so on. So our investment in that regard has been climbing year after year. Many resources have been devoted, but it's all worth the money. This the latest injection is it shows to go the government's long-term and committed commitment towards promoting green environmental protection. Apart from encouraging different groups to launch green projects, we think that green projects have to be taken at the district level. So we've got this new initiative. We will be launching a series of community green stations at the district level to promote the green culture at the district. In the first phase, we propose to establish five community green stations across the territory. We hope to build a green community in Hong Kong overall. It's a healthy, livable, and good a city, suitable for living. Thank you, Secretary. 15 members have indicated the wish to speak, or 16 of them. I would be reading them your names one by one slowly. Please remember your order. Chen Hakan, Wong Kwok Hing, Gary Fan, Chen Hanpan, Stephen Ho, Kenneth Chen, Charles Mok, Elizabeth Kwok, Helena Wong, Lo Wai Kwok, Chong Kwok Pan, Chen Kim Po, Christopher Chung, Sin Chung Kai, Fernando Zhang, Gary Fan, Guang Yihan, Dennis Kwok, sorry. Have I missed anyone? Did I not mention Tony Che and Dennis Kwok? So 18 members altogether. We can't afford 5 minutes. We can't even afford 4 minutes. It will add up to 72 minutes. So can we set it at 3 minutes and a half? Yes? Okay. 3 minutes may be too short. 3.5 minutes. Please stick to the rule. If you use up all your 3.5 minutes, then the secretary will not have a chance to respond to you. We've got 18 members on the queue. So 3.5 minutes. I would strictly control the time.
Ms. Gary Chen and then Mr. Wong Kwok Hing. Madam Chair, question for the secretary about waste treatment. I'm glad to hear that you have the waste reduction over the next 10 years, that it will be one-third reduction. Whether we can, it is achievable, let's wait and see. Now, you keep talking about the fact that we have a lot of food waste in our waste. One-third of Hong Kong's population is living in public housing estates. Why is it that you don't collect the food waste from these public housing estates? They may be difficult with the private buildings, but these buildings are managed by the housing authority. Why are you not doing it? In future, when we construct new housing estates, will you be setting aside any facilities for handling waste and food waste in particular? And Mr. Secretary, you keep talking about money. We agree with the responsibility system, but now we are charging for electrical waste, plastic bags, and bottles, and so on. Now we're contributing the money, but you're not really taking the money for environmental causes. Will you be giving the undertaking that the environmental levy will be plowed back to the environmental cause? Secretary? Madam Chair, Mr. Chen, to answer your question simply, in similarly dense cities, they would put commercial and industrial sectors first because food waste is easier to collect. Be that as it may, in public housing estates, it's not the case that we're not doing it, although we're doing it on a smaller scale. We are supporting some private housing estates to engage in collection of food waste. We've covered 11 housing estates for the first phase, and the second phase is under application. There are going to be 45 housing estates that we can get on with the food waste collection. We'd like to do so in the high-density, low-density, medium-density estates. And we'd like to do more in this direction for public and private housing estates. Now, we have the Green Building Steering Committee, which promotes low-carbon living. And we'd like to take the opportunity of new buildings to achieve environmental protection. Now, we have the waste, electrical and electronic products, bottles, and plastic bags. We have the funding for a specific purpose, and we like to produce the recycled economy. Mr. Chen, well, the Secretary has a new understanding for this special fund for special use. Now, for this levy collected from the waste, are you going to use it for promotion of environmental education? Secretary, well, we do need more education. Sorry, Secretary, you might wish to add a little bit in just a few moments. Mr. Wong Kuo-heng and Mr. Gary Fan. Madam Chair, through the Chair, I'd like to put this to the administration. In terms of air quality, you've done a lot of work and you're promoting low-carbon living. In this regard, my question for the Secretary is this. Now, we are subject to light pollution. Will the administration be enacting legislation to protect public health? There are similar problems in many districts. Last week, the Wan Chai district councillors came and met us, and they've lodged this complaint, and they urged us to bring this up with the administration. I think today is a very good opportunity for us to do so. So in terms of light pollution, will the current term of administration be conducting any study, or whether you will be going down the legislative path? Secretary, the new administration is very concerned about the external lighting or the light pollution. We do have a committee looking at this area. By the middle part of this year, there will be specific recommendations. One of the ideas is to learn from other jurisdictions, like by 11 p.m. or midnight, all the non-essential lighting will have to be switched off on a compulsory basis. I mean, this is the direction that we're looking at. Rest assured, members, we are just as concerned. We'll do something about it. Mr. Wong, thank you very much for the direct response. My second question is also on pollution. I'm not sure whether you would consider this, and that is the pollution of Hong Kong is lagging behind Shenzhen 50 times. Now, my question for the Secretary is whether you would be conducting any study on this laser pollution. Secretary? Well, we've heard similar views, and there were suggestions that this be picked up by the administration. Honestly, the Bureau has very heavy agenda, but we have to move in this direction. But we have to prioritize. We have to accord priority on the more important issues. And we will discuss among our team and see how this can be taken forward. Mr. Wong. Well, thank you so much for the direct response, Secretary. And you are far more proactive than the officials in the previous term. And I'm glad to hear that you would study this, and you need to accord priority. I'm glad that you have made this response today. I hope that we don't have to wait for too long before we get to see the findings of your study. Mr. Gary Fan and then Mr. Chen Hanpan. Well, according to the paper, the waste reduction would be a top priority, and charging would be the next measure. Since the MSW measure was launched, we haven't done the WEEE, we haven't done the charging for the MSW. The food waste will not be done for good many years. The only thing we have done is the levy for the plastic bags. I'm concerned about the Northeast landfill. In 1982, we had the first phase, and then the second phase. The third phase is about to be full up. Now, 150 hectares of land, Zhongguano is a new town. Now, this is 1,500 hectares of land. One-tenth of the land is used for landfills. And this is about the size of 10 Victoria parks. I don't think the administration should indefinitely, incessantly expand this landfill. Now, we have this horrible odor and stench emitting from the landfills. Now, Aloha's Park took this picture in front of me. The garbage trucks are dumping illegally on a daily basis, and this is the result of an expansion of the landfill. Now, we've been talking about this for years and years on end, and the administration still cannot get on top of this problem. Why is it that in this Aloha's Park, I mean, there are 50 blocks with so big a population. Why does it have to insist on expanding the landfills? Secretary? Thank you very much, Mr. Fan, for the question. This is nothing new. What Mr. Fan said, we're all aware of the problem in Hong Kong and also the concerns of the Zhongguano residents. We'd like to be pragmatic. We'd like to have a comprehensive blueprint to deal with this issue. We are concerned about the impacts that these facilities might have on the nearby residents. As we said, I would like to mitigate the problems of concern to the residents living close to the landfills. Now, notwithstanding the expansion, we'd like to deal with the odor problem and also the vehicular traffic. But overall, we'd like to have a comprehensive blueprint so that we can have all the details available for members of the public. Mr. Fan, Well, the residents in Zhengguanluo have shouldered their civic responsibility for the past two decades, and one-third of the MSW have been dumped in Zhengguanluo. Now, by the time the third phase is full, then they will be closed. They will have outlived this usefulness. The government should not really impose any more burden on the residents there. Secretary, now with all these problems, we'd like to allow the members of the public to take a collective decision. Mr. Chen Hanban and Mr. Stephen Ho. Madam Chair, user pays principle is a very good principle, but it may give rise to some unintended consequences, like construction waste. We may have to pay for it, but you still apply this user pays principle. Now, from time to time, we see fly tipping occurring in back alleys and so on. Asbestos is highly polluting, and we've seen this being dumped all over the place. Going forward, will you be, or when you will vigorously tackle this problem and make the users pay, how can you make sure that there will not be any fly tipping all over Hong Kong, all over the countryside? Second, when the food waste is recovered, normally it would be used as fertilizer or as a feed for the fish. If we don't have a great deal of development in agriculture, will the administration consider in the nurseries in Hong Kong use the food waste as fertilizers so as to create some sort of incentive for the market? Secretary, I'm sure that the recycling of waste is the way to go the world over. Of course, we have to strike a balance with all the right measures. There is a newspaper report about some materials being dumped in the countryside, including some asbestos and so on. Now, we are very concerned about it, and we'd like to identify solutions to the problem. We will vigorously enforce the law. We will take measures to deal with it, and we are considering measures to nip the problem at the bud and to stop fly tipping in the countryside. Food waste. Composting and producing fish feed, I mean, there are limitations in Hong Kong. The composting in Hong Kong would utilize a very limited amount of the food waste, and we are talking about a fraction of the total amount of food waste that we produce. So in Hong Kong, we are facing limitations in using the food waste for composting purposes. So we have to have we consider building a center to deal with this food waste. In the blueprint, we are also talking about how best we can take advantage of this food waste for composting purposes.
Stephen Ho, followed by Mr. Kenneth Chen. Thank you, Madam Chair. I think the overall direction and the policy address is good, but then not all of them are good. About reclamation, to protect marine resources, the government has implemented several measures, including banning trawling late last year, and also commercial fishing will be prohibited in marine parks. If we all work towards that goal, then it's all right. But then the paper says that the trawling is prohibited for three reasons. Pollution in Hong Kong waters is caused by three factors. One is polluting waters in neighboring areas. There's too much dredging around the Hong Kong waters. And the third reason is trawling. Well, if we all work towards that goal, then that shouldn't be a problem. But then the policy address also mentions that the government is actively thinking about reclamation outside Victoria Harbour. Does the UNB talk to the Development Bureau on this matter? That's okay if you ban trawling, but are you still proceeding with reclamation projects? Secretary, please. I believe the members of the public are beginning to ask that question. I can't give you the details at this juncture because within the government, we will be holding discussions in that regard. Yes, there are conflicts. We've highlighted some major development directions, but as to what size will be used for what purposes, then that has to be further mapped out. So I can tell you for the time being that we would be resorting the existing mechanisms as gatekeepers, and for overall macro planning, the discussion on striking a balance between conservation and development will go on within the government. And I think the society will also be discussing the topic quite heatedly. I don't see any balance here because the policy address that says that some 2,000 to 3,000 hectares of land will be reclaimed is around 2-point-something percent of Hong Kong's land in total. So it means a lot. It means that what you're going to do in the next few years equals to what we've been doing in the past few decades. Well, what you are trying to make life difficult for the fishermen, or trying to control what fishermen are doing, but you are not doing it on the other sectors. Sorry, I can't. You can't go on, Undersecretary. Madam Chair, do we need to discuss it, the subject, on a sort of interdepartmental platform? Not just 2,000 or 3,000 hectares, but say, look, 600 hectares, that's what we're talking about. And for man-made islands, 2,000 to 3,000 hectares. In the past, the government would say that the land would be claimed for a specific purpose, like the airport or Disneyland. But this time around, we don't know what the land would be used for. I mean, the reclaimed land. Mr. Kenneth Chen and then Mr. Charles Mok. I want to follow his footsteps in sort of extending my speaking time. On water quality, Phase 2A project, you say that you would be doing more to improve water quality in the Victoria Harbour. Are you talking about 2B and 2C phases? 2A is about to be completed, and we are now assessing the effectiveness of the project. We find that on both sides of the Victoria Harbour, the water is quite clear. But then because the sewage are directly connected to the Victoria Harbour, then 2A or 2B phases projects might not be able to tackle the problem. So we will try to find an antidote to the question that I mentioned. I think the panel would be following up with the administration on that. About the injection of $50 billion on ECF, and you hope that you would support $5 billion. What are your plans? What kind of areas are you talking about? Is it food waste? Any publicity campaigns or what? Can you elaborate? We have set up a committee to make the best use of these resources. We would discuss with the panel on how to set priorities. The initial thinking is that we will set our priorities according to the seriousness of the problems we are facing. We think food waste should be a focus, energy saving, ecological conservation, general education. All these areas are also crucial. That's the more or less the priority that we are thinking about. We will have come up with some suggestions and we'll discuss with the panel. Well, there are so many people, so many problems around Hong Kong. So I think food waste, if you want to focus on food waste, then we can sort of focus all our efforts on that aspect and we can initiate changes, hopefully. About earmarking $10 billion on replacement of commercial diesel vehicles. You have set a timetable of 2016 to replace or phase out all pre-Euro buses. Can you advance the timetable a bit? It also touches on the livelihood of the trade. The trade is very concerned about whether the car agencies will be making netting the profit, and would it be forcing drivers out of their jobs and so on. So can you elaborate on what kind of measures you would be undertaking to reduce or minimize the disputes? Several points. First, we have reached a consensus with the trade that we would spend the next month or so to discuss with them on how to strike a balance between conservation and their livelihood issue. It's Mr. Charles Mok and Miss Elizabeth Quat. Madam Chair, I would like to follow up on emission from diesel commercial vehicles. Have you reached a consensus with the trade? I don't want to see the situation that the trade objecting this strongly and then the program will be delayed. About the Kai Tak cruise terminal, you said that you would have onshore power facilities, but then there will be a very big park nearby and a sports city. And then over 10,000 housing units in that area. If there is pollution from vessels and people are jogging there, then that would be a great problem. Have you made an assessment on whether there are enough support facilities to for your initiative? I'll tackle the first question and the second question tackled by the Undersecretary. We have been maintaining a close dialogue with the trade before we launched the scheme, and now we are discussing with them closely. And actually, a lot of the initiatives are made in response to their demands and to how to avoid the car companies netting the profit, or those who are some drivers are about to retire. So we have this option of allowing them to scrap the cars. So in the next month or so, we would hold more in-depth discussions. We would hope to legislate as soon as possible as far as the cruise terminal is concerned. If we can legislate in the next legislative year and come up with a timetable and allow mandating the vessels to switch fuel while berthing, then that may take, say, 2 to 3 years. As what Mr. Mok said, there will be other facilities around the Kai Tak area. When these facilities are in place. The power facilities, the onshore ones, will already be in place, I suppose. So the ocean-going vessels will be emitting no exhaust pollutants when they are berthed there. Are we going to require them to switch to fuel when they are entering the harbour? We've heard your view, and that's something that we can discuss as a next step. Any follow-up question? You've got 30 seconds left. Well, just one more word. So I think the Secretary, you should work harder to discuss with the trade, and we don't want to see the proposal going back and forth. I see the biggest objection coming from the trade. Now, as for Kai Tak cruise terminal, if we can do an assessment on the air pollution, and then that would be good. And Ms. Elizabeth Kwot, and then Mrs. Helena Wong. Thank you, Madam Chair. Janko Wenho residents are finding the odor of the landfill a nuisance, and there is air pollution along the highways there. Wan Po Road, I've raised whether at Wan Po Road, and the area can be designated a low emission zone. Can the administration think of measures to reduce pollution at Wan Po Road to protect residents' health? My second question is about nature conservation. Mr. Stephen Ho said that great controversies surround the marine conservation. We are not very familiar with our marine environment, the ecological value at various parts of the Hong Kong waters. Would the government think about coming up with an overall report to let us know the value along the coastline or within the harbour? And then we will be able to avoid the situation where we have to consider the projects on a case-by-case basis when it comes to the EIA stage. Now, it seems the government doesn't have any measure on seashore cleaning. And we see that that we've got such a good coastline, but then it's littered with rubbish. Has the government thought about measures to clean up that rubbish or employing fishermen to do cleaning work? Also, we eat a lot of seafood. So will the government take the lead in not supplying endangered fish species like shark's fin and endangered fish species and so on? I've got some time left. I would also like to raise that for buses, PLBs, taxis, for the retrofitting of the catalytic converters. Is there a timetable? Well, I think the shark's fin has disappeared from our menu for a long time, I think. Thank you, Ms. Kwot, for your five questions. Wan Po Road. We understand that residents are very concerned about all the sand and dust emitted from the vehicles. Not just vehicles going out in and out of the landfill, but other vehicles as well. In line with the expansion plan for Zhangguanluo landfill, we will have a series of mitigation measures. Now, on Hong Kong's marine ecology, through the biodiversity strategy and action plan, we would be coming up with a plan on the entire coastline, how to conserve it. We would be compiling the statistics, and we hope to come up with a plan soon. As for the coastline of Hong Kong, there is this new measure. The Permanent Secretary will chair a meeting to an interdepartmental meeting to address the issue.
Yeah. Helena Wong, two questions I may. First of all, light pollution. At the council meeting, Democratic Party members did ask a question about the gleaming curtain walls reflecting light off them. There is nothing in the Buildings Ordinance to govern that, and neither is there anything in the Environmental Protection Ordinance. Now, we have a lot more and more curtain walls for buildings. In Western Kowloon, near Element, this ICC tower, at the bottom of the ICC, it has a curved design where all the residential properties are subject to the light pollution. So will you, in your term, consider all these reflection of the gleaming curtain walls of the tower blocks? If you're not going to do it, why is it you're going to do it? Second, I support the idea of reduction at source and also recycling, supporting for the recycling industry. Now, you haven't told us a lot about it. You merely talked about how you make use of the PCWA, lengthening the coastal area and so on. But in fact, the waste paper and metal recyclers are taking advantage of this. Now, I'm more concerned about timber. They can be recycled. Some green groups did approach you for assistance, and they are recycling Christmas trees. Now, they have collected 50 tons of old Christmas trees, and they've got no idea where to put them. And they are considering at the moment the recycling of New Year flowers, or the peach flowers. And there would be huge quantities that can be recycled. Are there any measures to assist in the timber recycling? Secretary, when you talked about the curtain walls and the highly reflective outer walls of tower blocks, and the reflection is causing nuisance to the nearby residents. Now, this is not something within the remit of the Light Pollution Committee. As a matter of fact, this also happened in other jurisdictions. In Melbourne, they have similar concerns. Now, they are not so much concerned about the impacts on the residents, but rather they are concerned about the impacts on the motorists because of the low angle of the reflection. In Hong Kong, this is a rather new subject, and we have to understand it a little bit better first before we talk about legislation. But we will encourage the sector to show more concern about it. Secretary, well, members, I'm sure we all know how we work here. If you read out all these questions in a wordy manner, there will be no time left for the secretary to answer. Secretary, I mean, you're free to answer the questions however long you like. Well, can the questions that remain unanswered be replied to in writing? Definitely. There is this question on reclamation. Now, I understand that this is a subject of crucial importance to Hong Kong. Perhaps the policy address is overly ambitious. This does have a grave bearing on Hong Kong. I mean, we may even give the entire 3 minutes to the Secretary or the Undersecretary. We may not be able to get an answer. But I will save some time for the Secretary or the administration, for that matter, to make a reply in summary. You might wish to supplement on the points that you'd like to supplement. Mr. Lo Wai Kwok and then Mr. Chung Kwok Pan. Madam Chair, I am concerned about recycling in the community. There is a pilot scheme mentioned by the secretary, and that is the recycling stations, the community stations. Now there are five pilot stations. I hope that there will be more. Now, in terms of the waste electrical products, at least there should be a recycling station in each district. There should be more than one station in each district. So after the pilot stage, how are you going to take this forward? The other thing about recycling is bottles. A couple of years ago, I did attend a ceremony on recycling of bottles. That was precisely 2 years ago at Tao Kok. 2 years on, the progress has been very, very slow. Now, we had these really very nice recycling bins that people were told that light bulbs could not go into these bins, only bottles. Now, the secretary mentioned the recycling of these bottles, but we're moving at a snail's pace. How do you expect we would be able to achieve the target? Secretary? Thank you so much, Mr. Low. Right, the community recycling stations, we have to put them in the community. And we're talking about a pilot scheme. By the end of this year, we should be able to get a couple of them done to be followed by the rest. And then we consider how we take this forward. As regards bottles, the recycling rate in Hong Kong is about 5%, if my memory serves me correctly. Now, we will have the producer responsibility system on bottles. According to the experience elsewhere, this can achieve a recycling rate of more than 70%. Now, we may not use the funding for specific uses, but we are promoting the recycling practice of bottles so that this sector would be able to survive. Madam Chair, this community recycling station, I'm glad we have such a pilot scheme. Can we have any idea about how this is going to be taken forward? Will there be a couple of such stations in each district? Now, you have two. I mean, by the end of the year, this is a pilot. I think you're moving far too slowly, and this may drag on for many, many years. What is your vision in this regard, Secretary? Thank you very much for your support, members. Well, it all depends on the availability of land resources. Mr. Chung Kok Pan and Mr. Chen Kim Po. Secretary, in Hong Kong, each person generates 1.36 tons of domestic waste, 30% more than Taipei. Why is it that we produce all this waste in this quantity? Is it because of the culture, the lifestyle that we have, or education, or what? In Taipei, in Tokyo, they are segregating waste at source, the bottles, the tins, the paper, electrical, the batteries, and so on. But in Hong Kong, everything goes into the bin. When the government considers, or before the government considers charging for MSW, the municipal solid waste, we have to start learning about the waste segregation source. Secretary, Madam Chair, 1.36 is basically the waste that we produce. Now, we're not talking about segregation here, like at meetings, we're so used to have a bottle of water. I mean, even in electrical, we don't use bottled water. We use glasses. So in our day-to-day life, these one-off items will produce a lot more waste. So the production of waste as source is a very serious problem. Segregation is also important. Right, can we stop the clock a little bit? Well, we don't make available paper cups. We make available the glasses. I'm talking about a meeting with members. We're given the paper cups. Well, I think it's a matter of education. Hong Kong people should change their lifestyle. Mr. Chen Kinpo and then Mr. Christopher Zhong. Madam Chair, thank you. Diesel vehicles, I'm glad that you are taking such massive action. We keep talking to the administration about it during the last term, that you're making it so broad. We were asking you to cover 38,000 the pre-Euro vehicles, but you are extending the scheme to cover 88,000 vehicles. Some of them are not all that bad, and that they may present difficulties to you. So I hope that you will focus your attention on Euro 1, Euro 2 vehicles, because they are contributing most to the emission. Like RSP, if a pre-Euro vehicle would be equivalent to three Euro 3, Euro 2 vehicles in terms of emissions. Now, as regards the exposure payment, the taxable values, now for 18 vehicles, not replacing the vehicles, 10%. What does it mean here? This is 10% of the taxable values of new vehicles. Is this the market price for this vehicle? Or is it really an effective rate that you're offering? Second, the government doesn't say much regarding energy efficiency on the part of the whole of Hong Kong. And this is going to be very important. I hope that you would put more focus on this. Can you elaborate further on this, please? First of all, about commercial diesel vehicles, let me clarify a little bit. Why is it that we cover pre-Euro all the way to Euro 3 vehicles? Now, RSP emission for pre-Euro 3, they emit many, many times more RSP than the Euro 4 or beyond. So we cannot look ahead into the longer or the medium term. I agree with members that we have to tackle the most polluting vehicles first, but we also need to have a medium-term measure from now to 2019 regarding the Euro 3 vehicles. They are also polluting. In overseas jurisdictions, they have a 15-year cycle. By 2019, all these vehicles will be hitting 15, 16 years. So we'd like to seize this opportunity to tackle these short-term and medium, long-term problems. Now, we look at the market price, and then we come up with a recognized market price as a percentage. I'm sure the market is aware of all the details.
We attach a lot of importance on promoting energy saving for the whole of Hong Kong, including new buildings, old buildings, and commercial buildings. We will note which buildings use the most electricity and will target those. Commercial buildings are definitely the ones who consume the most electricity, taking up 60%, residential buildings 20%. So with all these figures through our committee, we would be tackling or addressing the problems. Mr. Christopher Chung and then Mr. SIN Chung-kai. Thank you, Madam Chair. Two questions from me. One is about light pollution. It doesn't involve Wan Chai only, but in other urban areas, we are plagued by the same problem. Hong Kong is in modern city. Neon lights are very attractive to tourists. Can the government take reference from control of noise and dividing up or categorizing different districts into different zones. You've got this guidelines on industry best practices for external lighting installations. I don't think it serves much purpose. The figures or in the indicators are quite useless. Can you divide up the Hong Kong into different districts, say in the commercial districts, and you draw up a certain standards for the TV panels or displays? Now, for residential, purely residential districts, these flashing lights should be banned altogether because you create a nuisance to people's lives. For purely commercial business districts in central, say, or areas fronting the harbour, then I think we can adopt a more relaxed approach. Now, the precondition, of course, is that we shouldn't be affecting the drivers with all these lights going on. Can that be done, Secretary? Yes, the task force is considering something along the line you propose. Now, for buildings fronting the Victoria Harbour, then those who are living or engaging activities at the other side of the harbour, they will be affected. So, designating different zones for different control may create problems. For example, in the central district, it is both a commercial and a residential district. The issue is quite complicated. The committee will take into your account your comments. Well, what I meant is maybe central will be divided into different districts. About dumping of mud. Would you engage an expert to consider cooperating with mainland operators to dump the mud? Yes, the Victoria Harbour has been harmed considerably because of mud dumping. Can you consider some new measures? Yes, we would go back and see how a balance can be struck. Should it be handled locally, or are there any other options? We would look into that, Mr. SIN Chung-kai, and then Dr. Fernando Zheng. The $10 billion seems a very attractive amount in improving roadside air quality. Pre-Euro vehicles can survive for another 3 years, and then Euro 2 for another 4 to 5 years, and then Euro 3. They can be on the road till 2019. My question is, does the government have to amend your legislation? I've raised this suggestion before. Can we designate an area as low emission area? Say for vehicles allowed to run up to 2019, they should take their cars to you to be replaced, or else they will be banned from roads in Hong Kong altogether. An alternative is to just allow them to run on low emission control zones. The way you are doing it is the administration worried that there is no sort of midway solutions. The drivers might be taking radical action, and if they sort of block the road in Central in protest, then we'll be having a big problem. My response to Mr. Chen Kingpo's question and also your question, why do we have to regulate on Euro 3 vehicles as well? If we take the perspective of protecting people's health, we should go along that route. Or else by 2019, by 2020, we will not be able to achieve new AQOs. Now, second, are there any alternative solutions? We are bargaining with the trade right now. They understand our overall direction. Now, you suggest that we shouldn't phase them out and we ban them from entering certain parts of Hong Kong. I think that's a very different option. What I think is the most or the best solution is to replace all these vehicles altogether. Give us some time to discuss with the trade. So when are you going to put forward the legislation in the LegCo, or would you? Yes, we are definitely going to legislate before the plan is implemented. We want to put forward two pieces of legislation. One is the deadline for the pre-Euro, Euro 1, 2, 3 vehicles, and then the other piece of legislation is on that newly registered vehicles can have a lifespan of only 15 years. Dr. Fernando Cheng, and then Dennis Kwok. Nobody likes landfills or incinerators. Not to mention the harm done to the environment and the air pollution created. Zhangguanluo residents are adversely affected by the landfill. In the last term of government, it proposed building an incinerator. Without funding, the plan was shelved. Now, in this policy address, the secretary seemed to say that an incinerator may be built. I'm bewildered because these two projects are opposed by LegCo members. The costs of such projects are huge. We're talking about tens of millions of dollars, and the maintenance costs are also exorbitant. And some groups say that you spent so much, why is the government spending so much money to build projects which are not well liked by everyone? And we also have to, at the same time, reduce food waste as a source. We are producing 3,500 tons of food waste, taking up 30 to 40% of the food waste or the MSW. So what can we do to motivate all of Hong Kong to reduce food waste? For one NGO, it is recycling a huge amount of food waste, or 30,000 tons of food waste. Can we encourage more or hundreds of such NGOs to be established, and that can help us in reducing food waste, and rather not spend millions of dollars to build a very disgusting project, so-called disgusting project? You've asked, your question has been well put, Dr. Zhang. Let's look at the figures. We are determined to reduce food waste. We want to recycle the food waste and donate the food and so on. But if we look at situation in other places, there is a certain limit to the policies. We cannot achieve sort of benefits indefinitely. So through the blueprint to be drawn up, we will give out all the figures. Would the situation be as simple as what Dr. Zhang said? If we look at Japan, South Korea, Taiwan, Singapore, they have different practices. They are very advanced in that regard. their main focus is reduction at source. This is something that we are definitely going to embark on. In the next decade, we want to reduce one-third of our MSW. And also, we have to treat the waste ultimately. Dennis Kwok, I want to talk about water pollution. I don't think there is a lot of mentioning in the policy address regarding Dongjiang River. Civic Exchange has prepared a very detailed proposal on Dongjiang River, and it suggests that the administration should come up with long-term water strategies by 2014. What is the government's latest thinking on this? I recall that the CE has mentioned about G2G dialogue, how important it is. As for controlling water pollution at Dongjiang River, have we talked to the Dongguan government, Guangdong government, and the Jiangxi government? Are we working together on this? Water charge is not related to us, but clean water is within our remit, right? Yes, it is. What you mentioned is under the purview of the Development Bureau. I'm sorry, the paper that I wrote in the past is not all of them are related to the ENB. So for issues like that, should we take a sort of interdepartmental approach in tackling them? I think the development panel is looking after the water charges related to Dongjiang River, and I think the water pollution aspect is within our remit. Well, in the narrow sense, no, but in the broader sense, any pollution related to water and the air should be related to environmental affairs. So if you talk about purchased water, it's not within our remit, but then pollution of potable water, then it's related to us. I agree with the Undersecretary saying that is we should take forward the matter interdepartmentally. Dennis Kwok, do you have anything to follow up? If the Undersecretary doesn't want to respond, perhaps in the future we can join hands with the development panel to follow up, because in the policy address it says that the problem is serious. We're not just talking about the water charges and the supply, but also pollution. The Secretary is very clear about this, and we should be following up on. Then Kok Wai Kang, and then Tony Chair. The Secretary says that the administration will legislate on light pollution. We hope you can do it or expedite it. A lot of residents have been affected during daytime, and they can't sleep during nighttime, and they may suffer from mental problems and other physical problems because of light pollution. About diesel commercial vehicles, the colleagues say that they have to be replaced. We know from statistics that they are the key polluter. But then the owners of the vehicles are not offenders in a way. But then within the entire framework, it gives us the impression the vehicle owners are the offenders or the culprits of the problem. Now, you are giving a very tight deadline, but have you thought about that because of this deadline, the producers of the new vehicles will jack up prices, and the trade will find the new prices unaffordable? Can we boost economic incentive to encourage them to replace the cars? Because these are car owners and vehicle owners under very heavy financial burden. And what you're doing is really a sort of making life difficult for them. Let's not force people out of business because we want to protect the environment. On the cruise terminal, the policy address says that there will be a new harbourfront authority. Of course, we enjoy having a good harbourfront that we can enjoy. We don't want to see the scene where exhaust film is being emitted at the harbourfront. Now, the Undersecretary said just now that legislation will be put in place to mandate fuel switch. That will only be tabled before the next legislative year. Can you do it within this legislative year? Now, in this two-year interim period, will there be measures to protect or safeguard people from suffering because of the emission of the heavy fuel?
Secretary, well, I heard different views about the commercial diesel vehicles. Some said that we are leaving it too long. Others said that we are too aggressive about it. So we have to strike a balance. Also, on the question of the car dealers jacking up the price, now we have to make sure that we benefit the drivers. Now, it would take four years or so for the vehicle, for the installment to be paid off. Now, we're dealing with a cycle of 15 years, and this is the right thing to do in as in the case of other jurisdictions. Mr. Kwok Wai Kong, the cruise terminal secretary, we will get on with the legislative work regarding fuel switch. Mr. Tony Che, well, the question on the air quality, because not only is it detrimental to public health, it would be a detrimental to economic development. There were some overseas companies who would consider air quality in their choice of Hong Kong. In 2011, we had all these high statistics. Now, Mr. Mok referred to the Kai Tak cruise terminal. If I may seek further clarification, have you conducted any studies? I am concerned that there would be economic incentives which will be overriding the environmental consideration. Now, these ocean-going vessels are causing a lot of pollution. I hope that you will legislate sooner rather than later. It would be difficult, in absence of legislation, for you to come to any conclusion. Now, without the cooperation of the Pearl River Delta, I'm wondering whether the legislation to be put in place will be as effective as it should be. Undersecretary, we understand that members would like to see legislation enacted as soon as possible. We will get on with the drafting work as soon as possible. There are certain details that we are discussing with the shipping industry. We get on with this. By the time we come back from the summer vacation, we can introduce this to the floor of the council and get this through with members' cooperation. As to whether we should cover the Pearl River Delta before we start the fuel switch, we have taken a decision that we'll go first, but in the meantime, we'll be liaising with the mainland authorities in this regard. Madam Chair, I'm concerned about the effectiveness. Perhaps the Secretary might wish to assess the situation with the commissioning of the Kai Tak cruise terminal. Maybe the focus of attention would be too much on the economy. I do think you should emphasize the economic benefits to the exclusion of anything else. If you put in place all these measures at the very beginning, would be much better. So it would be better for the effectiveness of these measures. Undersecretary, well, we are discussing with the sector all these ocean-going vessels, the emissions are very, very high. And they also visit other ports from around the world. There are many nice ports in other jurisdictions that would have similar requirements. So in Hong Kong, all these ideas are nothing new. Also, the passengers are just ordinary passengers. And if there is a good chance that the passengers will be benefiting from the fuel switch. Dr. Priscilla Leung. Right, I'm also concerned about the Kai Tak cruise terminal. And this is only one of the sources of water pollution. Over the years, and West Kowloon Dynamics has been publishing this water quality report. In the policy address, there is a mention of improving the water quality in Hong Kong, and we are bringing people closer to the water. Now, there are 2 points, if I may, to follow up. First of all, the development of the leisure activities by the coastal area, and also to develop tourism there. This includes the coastal, the water frontage, and also the ferries. We don't really want to see the ferries, ferry services being closed one after another. I think we have to make sure that ferries will be developed as part of tourism. It doesn't take a lot of resources. Transport, tourism, environment should be mentioned in the same breath. Now, with regard to water quality, I hope that you would seek more resources to engage more talents who are specializing in water quality in universities. There are some graduates who are specializing in water quality, and they said that they're not given all the attention that they deserve. Now, we should also talk about the vessels and all the human factors when it comes to water quality. The DSD, the HAB, they're dealing with the expedient connection, the Marine Department, the Development Bureau, and the EPD. I'd like to put this to the Secretary here. In Tai Kwok Chui, To Kwa Wan, Hong Ham, and Tim Sa Chui, we follow up on the water quality there. We find that the EPD is very eager to get things done. But because of the sheer number of departments involved, it would be very difficult for them to get anything done as much as they want to. And I hope that you would be vigorous enough in coordinating all the departments. We did liaise with Mr. Henry Tang and Mr. Donald Zeng on this particular issue. I think we should have a higher level entity that is dealing with the water quality. The CS deal with the water quality. The PCWA, and how are you going to deal with this in future? And this is just by way of a comment, and there is no need for a reply. Ms. Dr. Priscilla Leung, we have imposed a 3-minute restriction on each member. We cannot really bend the rule here. Mr. Wu Chi-wai, Madam Chair, we're all concerned about environmental protection. In relation to the diesel vehicles, there is a replacement program going forward. Euro 5 and Euro 6. All these vehicles will be subject to a cycle of 15 years. Now you're asking the practitioners in the trade to change into these vehicles. I mean, is it the case that there will be new models coming on stream, and that's why you impose the lifespan of 15 years? I'm just wondering whether there can be more lenient treatment in terms of the lifespan of the vehicles. The second issue is the promotion of electric vehicles. Now, this is something we'd like to see happen, of course, but when it comes to low-carbon living and so on, the government doesn't seem to be very keen on the idea of bicycles. In the mainland of China, they have the mopeds, and they use this kind of vehicle an awful lot. And I'm wondering whether this can be achievable. If this can get off the ground, I'm sure that it would help people in the choice of modes of transport. People don't really have to use the four-wheel vehicles. They can use mopeds or bicycles, the two-wheel kind of means. And also in Power 48, the administration said they have to lead by example, and there will be a carbon audit. And it seems to me that things are moving pretty slowly. There are 40 government departments that have conducted an audit, or work is going on at the moment. In the process of a carbon audit, I'm wondering whether the work will be speeded up so that the government can set a good example. And improve the electricity consumption or energy consumption, for that matter. Also, the water conservation. I'm wondering whether there is any plan during this particular legislative year that will be put in place, or will you be leaving this until next year when you're dealing with the Dongjiang water, right? Stop the clock now. I would just like to remind members that water resources fall within the remit of the development panel. The quality of the water, I mean the cleanliness of the water, can be discussed here. But I mean, when it comes to the agreement, I mean this is the development panel. Water conservation, well, that's falls within the development panel, I'm afraid. Thank you. Right, Secretary, your reply, please. Thank you. Now, Madam Chair, these are vehicles. We expect technology to be advancing on a daily basis. In the mainland of China, they also have a lifespan imposed on the commercial vehicles. These are taxis. They have restricted the lifespan from 6 to 5 years. We are increasingly concerned about air quality, and that explains why the stricter standard. The other issue, the transport issue, has to do with the various departments. We have to consider them in detail. Carbon audit, there are 120 buildings that are subject to a carbon audit. We will pursue this vigorously. Mr. Albert Chan. Well, we're going to have a subject on the dumping of construction materials at the next meeting. I hope that you will include the Pui-O as well. In many areas in the NT, fly tipping is a very serious problem. The same can be said about Lamo Island. We have received complaints, but I mean, there is nothing much that has been done about it. This fly tipping, particularly involving asbestos, and the problem is getting more and more serious.
When I met with the Secretary earlier, I mentioned this. There is this one important point, whether the government has the resolve to go down the route of legislation on separation at source. If you don't have that determination, you talk about incentive, waste charging, and reducing the volume of waste, And the secretary also mentioned a certain percentage of reduction within a certain years. All these talks don't make a lot of sense. You should have the determination, the sincerity, and the courage to legislate on separation of garbage at source. Many countries have already done that. I've raised this to many secretaries in the past. And when we visited Taipei, we didn't believe that it was it could be successful. But then Taipei was a success, and the Taipei people are very proud of their achievement. But then Hong Kong people lack the courage and the green awareness to carry it out. I think the secretary has the determination, but not the other bureaus or departments, because support from bureaus and other departments are very important. So I hope to say this to the secretary. Please don't dwell on the handling of waste and how landfill is not inadequate, how to build an incinerator. All these will be useless if you don't talk about legislating on separation on a source. You're just like banging your head against the wall. Would you be telling us that you would be determined in the next year to legislate on separation of waste at source? Secretary, Madam Chair, Mr. Chen, thank you for your encouraging words. On top of separation of waste at source, what's more important is that on average, Hong Kong people produce more waste than other countries or regions. So on top of separation, this is a more pressing issue that we need to address. We have to adopt a multi-pronged approach on whether to legislate on separation at source. We are heading towards that direction, but we have to have the relevant support facilities before we can embark on that. Now, if the secretary remains entangled in that kind of those sorts of issues, it will give us an impression that you don't have the political courage to carry out what I proposed. You are trying to stall the issue, really, secretary. I have also my question. I will stick to the 3.5 minutes rule myself. Now, for the remaining 10 minutes or so, we've got Helena Wong and Mr. Wu Chi-wai who want to raise questions in the second round. And then when I'm finished with my 3 minutes, and then there will be 1 to 2 minutes left for each of you. I would suggest that we do away with the second round, and I will leave more time for the secretary and the undersecretary to supplement on salient points. I will leave it up to you to tackle issues in the remaining time. Now, on the producer responsibility system, we made consultation. Major appliances like refrigerators, conditioners, washing machines, we are considering at what point, at retail or wholesale or what, will a levy be charged? But for small electrical appliances like and computers and batteries, what is going to happen to those items? Now, we now depend on voluntary organizations to deal with these items. Actually, for small items, it's easier done. We can just readily take these items back to the retailers and that can be recycled readily, and it won't involve having to send people to go to people's homes and recover those items. So will the government consider, on top of the major electrical appliances, small electrical appliances, which are quite handy to carry about, will a PRS be implemented on these items as soon as possible? Madam Chair, on the PRS, for EEE after the public consultation for small electrical appliances items, whether the coverage should be expanded. Yes, that's a point raised by some people too. The majority opinion is according to overseas experience. The PRS is targeted initially first at major electrical appliances, and then the small appliances will follow in the second or third phases. From statistics gathered from landfills, small appliances like mobile phones, the disposal rate is quite as low, and there is a very active market for these items. For example, in the mobile market, there is this trade-in mechanism. Since we've got this very active second-hand market, we would not put a lot of priority on small these items. We would first proceed with legislation on the big electrical appliances. We will cooperate with the NGOs, and if they the consumers don't want to put their items on sale on the property second-hand market, we'll recycle them through the NGOs. If for the household appliances, if NGOs can offer maintenance services, then they can be reused again for the underprivileged families. If resources are inadequate, can the administrator devote more resources for recycling these small items for use by households in need? Well, I've heard your view, Madam Chair. We are now working with various NGOs. They are doing a very good job in as far as coverage is concerned. On donation and recovery of small items, we would continue to talk with them. If more points needed to be set up, we would do so. I will not go into a second round of questions because we have to hand over the meeting room to see the financial services panel meeting. So for the remaining 7 minutes, I'll hand the time over to the secretary. Please speak what you want to say. Well, I would focus on the major principles here. For the details, you can really look at the paper. Now, on air pollution, apart from the $10 billion, there are two other schemes. The two are also related to converters. One is retrofitting MNP LBs and taxis, and the other is on franchised buses. These three programs are launched because we want to reduce roadside emission. The biggest threat to Hong Kong people happens when they walk on the streets. Many people actually work, say, alongside buses and vehicles, and people may live on the first and second floors, and the windows outside the windows are just a traffic going by. And so if we want to protect people's health, we have to do more to reduce roadside emission. That's why we devote so much resources on banning Euro 3 vehicles. So by 2019 and 2020, if we want to achieve the AQO, we have to take those sort of measure. We have to go all out on that front. Apart from air quality, the ENB will compile statistics and information. To come up with a comprehensive and integrated approach to take forward discussions on waste treatment and energy conservation. With all these statistics, the entire community can discuss the matter and set priorities in a more rational manner. So our aim is to, in the first quarter of this year, we will publish two blueprints One is air quality, and then waste recycling. And then also green buildings. A similar approach will be undertaken. Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you for members for attending and raising your questions. If you haven't been able to answer our questions fully just now, please supplement with a written reply. Okay, thank you, the government officials for attending.